Hey everyone, welcome to my channel. Today we'll be learning about AWS CodeCommit, and this is the first video of this DevOps with AWS series. So let's get started. Okay, so what is AWS CodeCommit? AWS CodeCommit is just in simple words managed Git solution. Like you see in the GitHub, you see the GitLab. Similarly, AWS have their own solution, AWS CodeCommit. Here you will have a lot more privacy, I will say. You have more full control than the other solutions. You don't have to manage that, you don't have to manage server, you don't have to patch system, nothing. You don't have to do anything. You just focus on the repository and do the coding, and that's it. Okay, so enough talk. Now let's get your hands dirty with AWS CodeCommit. Just first log in your system. So normally, you'll have this screen. If you go and log in AWS, this screen will see. There, search for AWS just CodeCommit. Search for CodeCommit here. It will direct you to the CodeCommit console. There, click on the create repository. There, asking for the repository name. Give say YouTube demo, demo repo. You can say description. If you wanted to add something, add. Otherwise, no need. Let's click on create. Okay, see, there is a warning. You are signing as a root account. You cannot configure SSH connection for a root account. HTTPS connection for a root account are not recommended. Consider signing using IAM. So as for the warning, let's create one new IAM account. So let's go to IAM, is Identity Access Management. There I'll just create a new account. Okay, so click on users, click on add user. Let's say CodeCommit demo. Okay, say YouTube demo. Let's say CodeCommit YouTube demo. I need the program meeting and management. Let's say auto generate password. I need to change the password. And let's attach admin access to this user. Click on tags, no need to add tags. Review, and yeah, we have our new user created. I will just download the details so that I can use these details to log in. And this is the login URL. So let's click on it. Okay, so let's come and SS DAS 031. Let's have, I think it's CodeCommit YouTube demo, and the password is this. So yeah, let's do the login, and now we are locked in the new user. Just give it some second to load. Click on the AM again. Sorry, click on the IAM again. Go to the users. Okay, this is the new user, CodeCommit demo, that is we already logged in with now. And there we will create our access. Okay, let's go to security credentials tab, and there click on generate credentials. See, there is HTTPS git credential for AWS CodeCommit. We have to just generate our credential from here. Click on generate credentials. Make sure to save this this CSV file, or note down the username password for later usage, and keep it in a very secure location so no one can access that one. This is very much required, that no one should be able to access your credentials, right? Okay, let it open. This is my username and this is the password. Okay, so we have our username and password now. Let's close it, and now let's come back. Let's go to the CodeCommit tab. Let's go to the CodeCommit page. Okay, so now once the CodeCommit page loads, there you have to click on your repo. See, there you will get the repo link. This is the repo link. To clone the repo, you have to use git clone and then the repo URL. So let's do it. Asking for username, and we have our username here. Let's copy it. and we have a password. Let's copy the password from here. And we have our repo set. Okay, so the let's see cd demo repo, and it's a blank right now, and that is fine. Okay, now if you do the refresh page, you'll see the same screen again because you don't have any code to show. Okay, let's add some code here. So we have our blank repo. Now we'll add some codes. Okay, click on here, open folder, and point it our demo repo folder. Okay, now if this folder is now blank, let's add some file. Let's say sample, or like say sample is good enough, sample.html. okay, now if you go here in status, you will see the file is created. See, is untracked now. Let's give some like h1. Call it demo app version 1. Okay, and let's okay. Now you just like normal Git, you can check the status by the Git status. There you see is untracked, so we have to add it for tracking. To add it, there you can, there is multiple ways to add this file. Okay, so first one is Git add, then directly file name like this. You can do like that, or you can like, if you want to all the files, let's say there is 4 files, let's say add like dem sample 2.html, and if you go here and do git status, you will see 2 files, right? 2 files now. Okay, let's rename this one. Okay, sample and sample 2. Let's say just the demo app, no version, or version 2, whatever you want to tell it. So git add the file name. This is how you can add it, or you can do like git add either dot, or you can do minus a, and you'll see all file will be added to tracking. Okay, now we have added the file for tracking, and we are done. Suppose we are done with the changes. Now we should push the changes to the remote repo. How can you do it? Git commit minus m, let's say initial changes. Okay, now to push it actually in the remote repository, git push origin master. Okay, if you do that, you will see all these two files code will be moved to the remote branch here, remote master branch. Give it some time. Okay, see those two files added under master branch. Okay, now like just like normal Git, we can add new branches, and we can merge branches, and we can do all this kind of stuff. So let's add one new branch. Like think about that. I mean, if you have like 5 or 6 or maybe more many developers working in a single project, they're developing different features. If they directly work on the master branch, then everything will get messed up, right? You should never do that part, to be honest. What you should do, you should create always for the new feature or new fixes, you make a new branch, then get it, create a pull request, and then after the pull request approved, then merge the code with the master. That's a normal flow. If you want to learn about all this Git branches and you know Git merge and Git this atomic Git flows, let me show how you can search it. Okay, so say Git branch, if you want to learn about Git branching, search it here and git branch, come here in this page. Okay, then you will see that git branch, all the like how it works, the common options, what you have, everything is there. Checkout, I will show you what the checkout do, what are the branch, how can you create the new branches, how to do the merging, we'll show, not a problem, okay, we'll show that. But know that everything already, the all the details are already available in the Google, you can search it and find it. Anyway, in the demo we'll show how to do it for code commit. I mean, ultimately it's just the Git, right, managed by AWS. For any Git, all the commands are still valid, okay. Now Git, suppose you are developing new feature and we are calling the branch as new feature branch, okay, the branch name itself is a new feature. So Git checkout minus b, when new feature, okay. So as soon as you do that, you will see Git status, we are on the branch, new feature branch, okay. Now let's make a change, okay. So let's say sample, say demo app version 3, just for example. So we develop everything, we are done with all the changes, and now we are okay to move the change in the new feature branch. So Git check status, there is a modified file, let's add it, let's commit it, say complete new feature changes, okay. Now you are done with the changes and you are okay with the changes. Now let's push these changes to the new branch. Now you cannot do just normal branch push because it's a new branch, right? So, and you don't have this new branch in the remote repository here. If you just go here, you will not see the new branch here. So you have to do git push origin, that means the original repo, that's a remote branch, a remote repo, there a new feature branch, okay. Git push in this origin new feature branch. So as soon as you do that, you will see the code getting pushed in the remote repo here. It's a new branch, new feature, and if we refresh the page, you should be able to see it. There you have it. So click on this branch selection and click on the new feature, and if you click on the sample.html, you will see, just let it load version 3, okay. Now you're okay, you're done with, suppose that you're done with your changes and everything, all good. Now you want to merge this code, this new feature code, to master branch. Normally what happens in master branch, you have your production ready code and you move and when you, as soon as you move the changes in the master, there should be automation to push the changes in the actual production server or staging server or pre-production server as you choose, okay. For now we are not going to that complexity, but in the upcoming series videos we will be showing that, okay. So stay tuned, okay. For now, let's, you are done with the changes in the new branch and you want to move all these changes from this branch to the master branch. So for that you need to create a pull request. So we just clicked on the create pull request. We want, the destination is master and the source is new feature branch, okay. Let's compare. If you want to compare like what changed, so you can click on the compare and see what actually changed. In the changes you will see this thing happened. We are done, we have seen that. Now give it title, new feature merge with master, create a pull request. So as soon as you create a pull request, there should be some notification or something, so the senior developers get notified and they will give you the code and they will approve the code. There should be that kind of flow. We'll show how to do that, but let's finish this one. So simply you have developed a new feature and you are done with this one and someone review it, and the deployment manager will click on the merge. Now you have to select which way. So there is fast forward merge, square end merge and three way merge. For now you don't have to go through all this complexity, maybe in the future videos we'll show. For this video, let's keep it simple and go with the default fast forward merge, okay. And there is an option for delete source branch after merging. So if you want to remove this new branch that is already done with the changes and you want to close the branch, always you have to select this one, If you don't, you want to keep the branch, you know, just in case of references, you can do it. Best practice is to delete that one because you don't need it anymore and it will save space, right? So now click on the merge pull request, and as soon as you do that, it will be merged. Yep. Okay. So now if we go to our repo and click on the, you know, branch selection, you will see no new branch because new feature branch we removed it, right? Okay, let's move to master branch, and since we merged the code, we should pull the changes. Git pull origin master. That way, all the changes, you know, after merges, whatever changes done is here. So if you click here and see the version 3 instead of version 1. Okay, so this is the normal flow, like normal Git, you know, adding the file and then committing it and then, you know, creating new branches and, you know, merging it. Okay, that's a normal flow. Now this bit more advanced thing. So what you want to do, suppose normally what happen, you're in your master branch or in a production branch, the code is for production related servers only. And suppose any junior developer puts the code into that branch and something goes wrong, there is a huge pressure will be on you. Like people will start calling, some feature might not work. You know, just Google is an example I think we saw a few days back, right? So how to prevent that to happen? So in master, no one can directly push the code or no one can just directly merge it. Okay, only some people will have the access and they will be review, they will review it and merge it by themselves. Okay, let's do that part. Okay, for that, in the Google, AWS has its own solution. So we have to make sure that code commit restrict master branch, right? So the first article, limit pushes and merges to branches, there is a policy which you need to add. So let's think about the use case. You have 10 or 20 junior developers or maybe mid senior junior developers, they are doing the changes, and one senior may be in charge to or two three engineer in charge to allow the merging. Okay, so what should you do? First go to IAM. Okay, go to IAM, there go to groups, because it's a group of developers, right? Create a group and let's say developers group. Okay, click on the next step. Oh, this is already there. So say demo app developers group. Okay, you want to give them full say full code commit access, full access. Okay, click on get group. So we have it here, click on the group. We have to, this is the inline policy, right? So we have to create an inline policy for that. So click on the inline policies. There is no inline policies, to create one click here, click on that custom policy, select policy name, master code commit master restriction. Okay, and let's copy paste the policy. Here you have to understand this part, these statements. Okay, so any explicit deny will, you know, take more preference over any allowing or any policy you have allowed any access. Okay, this get preference. So just in simple English, this get the preference over everything if it is any explicit deny. Okay, that's the best practices of the access. Now what denying code, git push, delete branch, put file, merge, all kind of merge and pull request to particular repo. I would say do it for all the repo, because you know that should be a good security practice for all regions. Okay, and I think we should do it for our master branch. like this. All looks good. Apply the policy. Okay, we did it. Now, just to see that this working fine, go to users. Let's go to users group, and you have created this group, right? YouTube community code commit YouTube demo group. Click on that, and if you come there, the groups. Click on the groups tab, add user to group, and there select this one, demo app developers group. Okay, add to groups. So now, if I try to push anything directly in the master branch, I should not be able to do that. So make it version 4. We change it. Let's add it for commit. Code changes. Now let's try to push it. Master. And we should get error. Yep, and we got the error. So as per the policy, we are not able to. Now normally what happens, suppose developer with a who have the access should be allowing the master. So what should do, just create a new branch, checkout minus b, say feature, new feature 2, and there you have this. So someone has to push the code, and if you go to code commit, let's say it's here. Let's go to code commit. There, you will see the branch here. See new feature 2 branch. And from that branch, create a pull request. And where do you want to merge it? In the master. New, call it new feature 2. So what do you think what will happen? Let's see. So if you click on create pull request, and happen, right? That is good. But what if you try to merge it? Let's see. See, whatever, just go the default one. See, you are not allowed. We have a explicit, look at the what? You have the explicit deny. I told you, right? Now, let's say someone who have the access to merge the branch can do the merging, right? So, go to IAM, and I'm just removing myself from the group and merging the code just to show that how the flow worked. So I'm going to I'm just going to users and removing myself from the group. So think about it, someone who is not in this group, like a senior developer group or some other group have added, who have this merging access. Now going back to code commit, and there click on the demo repo, and we have the pull request here. So someone will go to the pull request, some senior engineer, click on that, they will see what are the changes, and everything is good. They will click on the changes tab, they will review all the changes. Okay, and once they are good to go, they will either just approve it, or since nothing to approve here, I mean, if you are the only one to merge, just merge it. Okay, we'll go again in the fast forward merge. And merge. So if you go to the demo repo, only one branch, master, and let's pull the changes. You know, they're already saying, right, your branch is like ahead. Okay, we pulled it. Okay, now this is a normal flow that I want to show you. This is a security proxy also. Okay, now one more important thing that, okay, suppose junior developer, you know, make the pull request. As soon as they do the pull request or any such kind of event happen, how to get notified? Because getting notified is also important stuff. Like you will see in the GitHub or in the GitLab or Bitbucket, someone making changes or getting notified like that. So you can do the same thing via notifications. So how can you do that? So go to the, normally you will come to these repositories. Then you have to select your repository. In the left side, you will have option to settings. Okay, in that you will see multiple tabs, right? General, the repository name, description, default branch and all, you will get the option to delete the repository also. Notification part, so that's what we're talking about, right? Creating a notification. So anything happens, you want to get notified, right? So click on the create notification rule. Notification name, say I'm saying like code commit notification demo repo. Okay, full. If you do it full, I mean all the details you are sending, the basic only information providing the resource events, that will go. So let's say suppose you want to, for any commit happens, you want to get notification. For that, this one, on any new pull request, this one, any status of someone approving it, someone just overriding any approvements and all, for this one, this, for any source updated, for any like pull request created, status change, merge, all that. And branches, suppose someone get a new branch, someone deleting new branch, or someone updating a branch, you will get notification like that. So what is the target? There is multiple target, of course, SNS topic and AWS chatbot. So normally you can go with the SNS topic there, just to the target. I think we don't have one for this one, so we will create new, just a moment. So create target. Upon create target, you will see the SNS topic and the notification name. So let's say it's code commit notification. Okay, say the demo repo, just for the better identification. Then create, and this SNS topic will be created, and submit, and then you will get notified. Okay, this is the notification rule, and what is the target? This is the target. One more thing is that sometime what happens when any events happen, you, instead of, you know, SN trigger, you want to trigger a lambda to notify, just suppose posting something in the Slack or some other, you want to get some notification to other things. In that case, you should use trigger. So let me show how the trigger works. The triggers, if you click on the create trigger and set trigger name like custom trigger, you can name it as you want. In the events, so what kind of events you want? All kind of repository events, or suppose someone pushing to existing branch, creating a new branch attack, deleting a branch, say push to existing branch. Okay, what branch? Let's say master. So someone, suppose normally in what it happens, like someone say, pushing anything to master, you want to get notified, you can use normal notification, or if you want to post the data in the Slack, you can just do like that. How you want to get it? You want to do it by SNS, like a notification, or you want to do by the lambda. Normally if you want to post in Slack, you should just use AWS lambda and execute a function where you have the code to post the data in Slack or whatever you want. Let's go with the lambda. Let's say any example. Suppose I have a function already. So that function, or you can create one, that's up to you. If you want to send any custom data, you can send in this field, say create table. And that's it. Okay, so I have covered all the basics in this session. I'll be covered more advanced, just a bit, in later. See, next week I'll be showing from the code commit how the code will go to code build. So next week will be code build. Now one important thing, for any you know tool you're going to use, make sure you understand their cost part, because someone like they do work all this and they don't able to, they don't you know, they don't create the resources, and this is the problems. So first understand the pricing. I didn't mention the earlier, I wanted to keep it in the end just to make sure that you understand the pricing part. So first 5 active users are free, no cost. They are giving unlimited repositories, 50 GB of the storage. Of course, there is unlimited the storage also, 10,000 GB request per month. Now, for the additional users, like more than 5 or 6 users onwards, it's $1 per month, unlimited repositories, of course, 10 GB per month per active users, for additional users, of course, 2,000 GB request per month per active users. Okay, that will get free with this charge. For additional, if you need more than that, additional charges, that is more than, like suppose you have new user more than 50 GB plus 10 GB for the particular user, you will see $0.06 per GB. Additional GBs, this is the cost, and additional GB request, this is the $0.001 per request. So keep in mind that part. Okay, so I hope you understand all this is the basic stuff like normal Git. You should be able to, you know, get started very quickly, as easily as shown in the video. So best of luck with that, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel, and yeah, let me know in the comments how did you like the video, what you want to learn about Etcod Commit in the future, and stay tuned for the next week session. Bye.